Welcome to the Chicago Urban League's 56th annual Golden Fellowship Dinner. Our program is about to begin. Please take your seats. Welcome to the Chicago Urban League's 56th annual Golden Fellowship Dinner. Our program is about to begin. Please take your seats.
Thank you.
Welcome to the Chicago Urban League's 56th Annual Golden Fellowship Dinner. Our program is about to begin. Please take your seats. Welcome to the Chicago Urban League's 56th Annual Golden Fellowship Dinner. Our program is about to begin. Please take your seats. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the Chicago Urban League's 56th Annual Golden Fellowship Dinner. The Golden Fellowship Dinner will begin in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Please welcome to the stage classical tenor Cornelius Johnson.
lift every voice and sing, till earth and heaven ring, ring with the harmony of liberty. Let our rejoicing rise high as the listening skies. Let it resound loud as the rolling sea. Sing a song full of the faith that the dark past has taught us. Sing a song full of the hope that the present has brought us. Facing the rising sun of a new day begun, let us march on till victory is won. Stony the road we trod, bitter the chastening rod, felt in the days when hope unborn had died. Yet with the steady beat have not a weary feet come to the place for which our Father sighed. We have come over a way that with tears has been watered. We have come treading our path through the blood of the slaughtered. Out of the gloomy past till now we stand at last, where the white gleam of our bright star is cast. God of our weary years, God of our silent tears, thou who has brought us thus far on the way, thou who has by thy might led us into the light, keep us forever in the path we pray. Lest our feet stray from the places, our God, where we met thee. Lest our hearts drunk with the wine of the world we forget thee. Shadowed beneath thy hand, may we forever stand true to our God, true to our native land.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome your host for the evening, comedian, actor, and Chicago's very own king of comedy, Damon Williams.
Everybody should be clapping.
When the world is on your shoulder.
Hey!
Gotta straighten
your ass. Yeah, I guess you can cut that, even though I didn't say so. First of all, everyone, grab your seats, please. Grab your seats. Welcome to the 56th Golden Fellowship Dinner. Everyone, grab your seats. Oh, I know I have to do shh. Can we start the evening by, first of all, giving Cornelius Johnson a round of applause for that fantastic rendition? You can do better than that, please. He sang that song. He might be the only person in the building that knew the third verse. So please, give him another round of applause for knowing the third verse. And if anybody here works with the NFL, that can solve your problem. Just play that one right after the other one, everybody standing. I want to thank the white people for standing for the song. You could have took a knee, but you didn't. Are you ready to have a good time this evening? I'm talking to all the dressed up fancy people. Are you ready to have a good time this evening? Make some noise if you're ready to have a good time. All right. I am Damon Williams, I am your host, and this is my sixth year hosting this, and I'm really glad to be welcomed back. Thank you. We're here to honor the extraordinary work of the Chicago Urban League. We're here to celebrate tonight not simply the journey that the Urban League has taken, but as we as Chicagoans will travel beyond tonight's event. A very special thanks goes out to our president and CEO, Ms. Sherry Runners. Give Sherry a round of applause. Y'all can do better now. I said the president and CEO, Sherry. Thank you for having me back. We're fortunate to have many elected officials, civic and faith leaders with us tonight. And on behalf of the Chicago Urban League, I'd like to thank the members of the clergy, elected officials, and matter of fact, let's have them all stand. If you're a clergy or elected official, please stand. Thank you all. We need you. Give them a round of applause for their service. We appreciate all the work you do, and we appreciate everyone in this audience for believing in the work this organization does. For being such great supporters this year and every year. Not only the league's incredible team, and I'm thankful to you, but so are the 1,500 men, women, and young people, or 15,000, I should say, whose lives have been touched and changed by the Urban League over the years. Be sure to post on your Facebook as well as tweet about our electrifying evening tonight on your Twitter page. The Twitter is Chi Urban League. And please use the hashtag. In fact, everybody get your phones out, because if you don't already have them out. If you've posted or taken a picture already, the hashtag is GFD56. And speaking of tweeting, let's take time. Matter of fact, everybody get a selfie right now. Just at your table, get yourself a selfie. I'm serious. Everybody take a selfie and post it with the hashtag GFD56. As if you haven't already. I see Brother David Miller. Go ahead, brother. Everybody getting your selfies? You getting them done? You know you got your phones out. You can't live without these phones. I hope you didn't stand in line yesterday to get a new iPhone, though. That's silly. All right. Now, let's get right to our fantastic program. First of all, we have great speakers in entertainment, but you do know who the headliner is tonight, correct? I'm talking to you. Do you all know? Ladies, do you know who the headliner is tonight? All right. But first, we have to recognize our 2017 Edwin C. Bill Berry Civil Rights Award honoree, noted civil rights attorney and community activist, James D. Montgomery Sr. Give him a round of applause. Please, decorum is in order. We're dressed up. We're bathed. All right. And we also like to thank our Lester H. McKeever Jr. Individual Service Award will be presented to a good friend of the city, a kingmaker, Mr. Emil Jones Sr. Everybody should be clapping. He's a progressive legislator and a longtime proponent for social justice and fair funding of public education. And of course, our entertainer tonight is a trailblazer. He's a songwriter, Hall of Fame nominee, inductee, I should say. He's 11-time Grammy winner, songwriter, producer. The great Babyface is in the building. And now, to bring greetings to us is a woman committed to representing the residents of Cook County. Please welcome the Cook County Board President and a fixture here for us. Y'all give it up for Toni Preckwinkle.
Yes, thank you. Good evening. One more time. Good evening.
Good evening.
Much better, much better. I'm honored to welcome you here tonight. The arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends toward justice. The arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends toward justice. Those are the hopeful words of Dr. Martin Luther King. You know, the President of the United States, 2 years ago when he announced his candidacy, described Mexican immigrants as rapists and murderers. This year, he described the neo-Nazis and white supremacists in Charlottesville as fine people. And I think it's a hard time to remember those hopeful and optimistic words of Dr. Martin Luther King. But we should also remember that the arc of the moral universe does not bend of its own volition. It takes the hard work of good and decent people day in and day out to bend the arc. And I want to thank the Urban League, the Chicago Urban League, for the good work that it does day in and day out to bend the arc. Thank you very much.
Please give our president of the county board another round of applause. She's always so quick and short to the point. And you know she's stressed out because the people revolted against the damn beverage tax, but who knew Orange Crush was so important? We love diabetes in our community, I tell you. Thank you, President Prepwinkle. Okay. Okay. As you can imagine, putting together the Golden Fellowship Dinner requires an immense amount of collaboration support from community leaders and hundreds of person hours. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in thanking tonight's host committee chair, Joe Moore, with Shell Oil. Thank you. Is Joe around? Where's Joe? Y'all see him? Okay. All right. And please, at this time, let's have our whole host committee stand. All the members of the host committee, let's give them a round of applause. Every member of the host committee. Thank you for your service. We'd also like to take time to recognize members of our Impact Leadership Development Program. Come on, show some love for Impact. The League's Impact Leadership Development Program builds a pipeline of future African-American leaders in Chicago. So let's give them a round of applause for their contribution to tonight's illustrious event. And now, ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming the co-chairs of the 56th Annual Golden Fellowship Dinner, Jim Kolar, Central Market Managing Partner at PwC, and Stephen Beard from General Counsel and at Hendrick & Struggles. Please show them some love as they come to the podium.
Thank you, Damon. I'm very honored to serve as co-chair of tonight's dinner alongside Steve. We've both been very much looking forward to this celebration, and our commitment to the Chicago Urban League is strong and long-term. At PwC, we take great pride in the fact that our active association with the League represents a very invaluable partnership. By joining us here tonight, you're helping chart a course for the League to drive transformational change, not just in their 101st year, but for many years to come. I'm very proud to stand here next to Steve, among valued colleagues, critical partners, and so many good friends who share our commitment to supporting the League's great work. Steve?
Thank you. Thank you, Jim. And thanks to each of you tonight for joining us for the 56th Annual Golden Fellowship Dinner. It's an honor and a privilege to serve as the co-chair of this event. And as you know, this dinner is more than just a party with a purpose. The money we raise tonight makes it possible for the League to deliver high-quality programs to more than 15,000 Chicagoans every year. Hydrick & Struggles and our partnership with the League is a testament to how strong we believe in the work of this organization. We're proud to stand with the Urban League as it works tirelessly to empower and inform and create opportunities for our citizens. As a native Chicagoan and a product of the South Side, I can attest firsthand to the significance of the work the League does to create economic opportunity, educational opportunities, and push for political and social justice. So have a great evening tonight. Thank you again for being here, and thank you to the Chicago Urban League.
Good job, gentlemen. Give them a round of applause. And thank you. That's Jim and Steve. All right. So now, their leadership has allowed us. Y'all, I'm moving too fast. Slow down. Okay, all right. And now, please welcome to the stage Eric S. Smith, Chairman of Chicago Urban League Board of Directors. Eric is wearing the black on black on black ensemble.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. First and foremost, I'd like all Chicago Urban League board members to please stand and be recognized for your work and service. As board members, we are intensely committed to seeing the League accomplish its goals. We have the admirable opportunity to work in partnership with the executive team and staff to help advance the organization's mission. Of course, one of the most gratifying benefits of serving on the board of directors is having the opportunity to bear witness to the lasting change that the League is making in so many lives. I would also like to take a moment to thank our lead sponsors tonight. Please hold your applause until all sponsors have been named. Our legacy sponsors are PwC and Heidrick & Struggles. Our innovation sponsors are Abbott, BMO Harris Bank, Boeing, Comcast, Grosvenor's Capital Management, ITW, Kirkland & Ellis, Loop Capital, McDonald's, and People's Gas. All of the companies and organizations that help make this event possible will be acknowledged on the screen behind me throughout the evening and are listed in your program book. Please join me in giving them a round of applause. We are truly grateful to each and every one of you who has contributed to the positive outcome of tonight's Golden Fellowship dinner. Tonight is going to be unforgettable. We're going to celebrate the League's 101st year to nourish and sustain our mind, body, and spirits for the challenges that lie ahead. And together, we're going to raise the funds necessary to make an astonishing impact on the city of Chicago, with the vision to transform it into a haven for the African American community. Thank you, and please enjoy the 56th annual Golden Fellowship dinner. And now please join me in welcoming to the stage our president and CEO of the Chicago Urban League, Ms. Sherry Runner.
Don't leave me. Stay with me. Thanks, Eric. What a pleasure it is to stand before you tonight. Every year, we remember and honor those whose vision, commitment, and pioneering spirit of empowerment and social consciousness created the Chicago Urban League. Tonight, we pay tribute to men and women who have advanced the cause of social justice by presenting the Edwin C. Bilberry Civil Rights Award. This honor is named for the passionate civic leader who served as Chicago's president and CEO from 1956 to 1969.
Tonight's Bilberry Award recipient is a perfect reflection of our theme, Beyond 100, Together We Matter. A husband, father, grandfather, and civil rights attorney who has paved the way for social justice through law and order. Ladies and gentlemen, please turn your attention to the screen for a look at the life and accomplishments of James D. Montgomery.
My name is James D. Montgomery, born in Mississippi in 1932. 7 years later, was transported in the back of the train to Chicago at the 63rd Street Station, and I've been here ever since. Thurgood Marshall in 1955 was invited to the University of Illinois College of Law, where I was a junior, third year. They asked me to escort him around the campus and to the dean's office and so forth. So I got to meet a man who was the salt of the earth. He talked to me about his period at Howard University Law School, where the dean would frequently catch him shooting craps in the bathroom. Aaron League has been an indispensable agency in the black community. It provides the research that gives the factual basis for our concerns as a people. I think it actually provides leadership in creating opportunities and training people how to be entrepreneurs. I think it's critical that they have been providing opportunities for young black people to learn how to be employees and to assist them in getting employment. So I think the Urban League has done a tremendous job. Hopefully, I can say without any difficulty that I have assisted at least in developing respect for African-American lawyers by the judiciary in this town and in this country. Certainly, in order to have change, you've got to have a community that is working together. And as African-Americans, without collective action, we are not going to have any success. And unfortunately, we are burdened with the history of slavery, and unfortunately that mentality where we're sort of sometimes behaving as if we're crabs in a barrel is antagonistic for collective action, and we need to deal with that. To be honored in the name of Bill Berry is outstanding in my judgment. I knew Bill, and Betsy Berry worked with Bill, really was an outstanding individual who did so much for us as a people and as a community, even to the point of being one of the major factors in the election of Harold Washington. So it's a tremendous honor to me to be afforded that award.
It is with great honor that we present the 2017 Edwin C. Bill Berry Civil Rights Award to a champion for civil rights and social justice, the noted civil rights attorney, litigator, and community activist, James D. Montgomery, Sr.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I thank the officers and directors of the Chicago Urban League for considering my life's journey worthy of the esteemed Edwin C. Bill Berry Award. I thank my wife, Pauline, and my children for allowing me the liberty to follow my passion for justice for my people. My humility dictates, however, that I confess my doubts about the long-term community benefits of my efforts. A glowing example is my litigating in the early 60s of a de facto segregation case against the Chicago Board of Education. We settled the case with the board's commitment to desegregate the public elementary and high schools. Today, 50 years later, the schools are more segregated than they were in the 60s. My years in the legal business and community activities have taught me that racism is a stubborn taskmaster. I have concluded, like many others, that the force that drives racism is white supremacy and alleged black inferiority. The White supremacy is maintained by control of financial institutions, natural resources, and corporate America. So long as white supremacy exists, black wealth will depend on the will of white America. There are no easy answers to the road to rectifying our condition. However, we must vigorously engage in the struggle for liberation and parity, however difficult the task. Frederick Douglass's ancient statement, quote, power concedes nothing without a demand, unquote, continues to be the path that we must follow if we are to be free. There was a time in our history when black communities enjoyed thriving business enterprises. These businesses provided employment for our people. In my lifetime, I've watched the erosion of black businesses and black employment. Blacks in America spend over $1 trillion annually. White America is the beneficiary of our buying power. I frequently argue with my family and friends that we don't spend our money with our own people. Unfortunately, too many of our people will not patronize black businesses and black professionals, even if the opportunity presented itself. On the other hand, given the absence of black businesses, large and small, our opportunities to buy black are limited. A part of the problem is many of us have bought into white supremacy and black inferiority. We believe that the white man's ice is colder. I can't tell you the number of times prospective clients have been told, quote, you better get you a white lawyer, you better get you a Jewish lawyer. Another issue for us is the apparent failure of some of our public officials that we elect to effectively represent our interests. This phenomena is not ill will on the part of these elected officials. It is an economic issue. Our impoverished community can't afford the high cost associated with election and re-election campaigns. These campaigns are frequently funded by white political leadership, except in Emil's case, and others. He who pays the piper calls the tune. So I leave you with this admonition: spend your hard-earned money where it will benefit your community. We have various ethnicities operating businesses in our communities, usually behind a glass shield. These people usually hire their own, not members of our community. These people don't live and spend in our communities. The only control we have is where we spend our money and with whom we spend it. To the extent that you spend, and I spend, unfortunately, 90% of your earnings with other ethnicities, you add to the unemployment and impoverishment of our community. I thank you for your attention and invite you to look out for my biography, which will be released in February of 2018. And as you might guess, it's entitled Full Circle: Race, Law, and Justice. Thank you very much.
Congratulations again to our Bill Berry Award winner. Let's give him a hand. This year, we honor those whose vision, commitment, and pioneering spirit of empowerment and social consciousness advance the League's mission of achieving racial equity. Please turn your attention to the screens for a closer look at a trailblazing client from our Center for Entrepreneurship and Innovation.
I grew up in the roughest, toughest parts of the city of Chicago. My childhood, it was extremely rough. Growing up as a teenager, being in and out of jail, 14 years ago was the last time I was in jail. After getting out of jail that last time, I think I filled out about 1,000 applications and just came to the realization like no one is gonna hire me because of my background. Me and my wife was talking one day and we just said that I was gonna go down to City Hall and apply for the business license, and it took off from there. It was easier to get my business license than it was to get a job. I knew that Chicago Urban League had endless resources, and we became a part of the program called the Next Level Program. It was amazing. I mean, I knew what a business plan was, but I didn't know what an implemented growth strategy plan was. And they had a pitch portion of the program where we pitched in front of potential investors and gave us a little bit more drive and ingenuity in how to help take this business to the next level. The Chicago Urban League has been the best thing that ever happened to a small business. The ways that they have helped us have also helped put food on other people's tables. So it's that right there is. You just can't make this up. I just can't thank them enough for everything that they have done.
Jimmy, you are truly an inspiration, not just for the League and its partners, but for the Chicago community. Will you and Jason Johnson, our director of the Center for Entrepreneurship and Innovation, please stand and be recognized? It is humbling to stand before you this evening at the start of a new century for the Chicago Urban League. On behalf of our board of directors, staff, auxiliaries, and the thousands of people we proudly serve each year, thank you for sharing this evening with us. Your attendance is a testament to the vision of the Chicago Urban League. It is alive and well. In the years since our last Golden Fellowship dinner, we have all lived through an unparalleled climate of political divisiveness that marginalizes not only black and brown people, but anyone who does not fit some people's vision of a true American. And we know now more than ever what the specter of the loss of hard-won rights looks like. And we know now more than ever that together we matter. To my daughters, my compound, my love for you is without end in a world where we seem to be in constant turmoil. I am grateful that we can navigate it together. It is through you that I can envision a future beyond this moment in time. And to the staff of the Chicago Urban League, the foundation of the league, there have never been more committed, passionate people who continue to prove that they are here because of their ability to simply believe. They envision the change that is possible and make it happen. And to the board, who remain steadfast believers in this cause far beyond the calling of their day jobs, all of this is not possible without your unmitigated support. The League's outspokenness and advocacy over the years has drawn praise and applause from some, but has also drawn the ire of others. My team and I continue the League's legacy. We remain driven by our mission to pursue socioeconomic justice for those who do not have it, and we are willing to put everything we have into the effort. Here here in the city of big shoulders, it can often seem that racial inequities nudge their way into every corner of our lives, pushing a story that is unflattering to us as a city and unfair to all of us. The League is at the forefront of contextualizing and changing this narrative. Through our Race and Equity Initiative launched last year, we are holding difficult conversations aimed at finding solutions to end structural racism. And to those who deny our toughest challenges are rooted in race, the words of California Congresswoman Maxine Waters, we say, we are reclaiming our time. For generations, black and brown citizens have endured a continuum of injustice that has always been about America's original sin, racism, and our bias and our battle with unconscious biases that underlie it. A former police superintendent once told me, "We all grow up with implicit bias, and we cannot expect people to operate without them. That is an excuse." It's important to know that we are not powerless against our racial biases. Each of us must take responsibility for breaking down racial stereotypes, for they are where biases and where the systemic problems that they justify begin. Unconscious biases have led to and helped maintain an unjust system of racial oppression that devalues black lives. The Chicago Urban League has worked to dismantle that oppressive system since our inception. So when we recognize that Laquan McDonald's death was going to be swept away or forgotten, despite the revolutionary work of the Department of Justice and the Police Accountability Task Force, we could not stand by and say nothing. The simple truth is, Laquan and Rakia, Tamir and Trayvon cannot regain their time on this earth. We will never know what they could have accomplished, and we cannot afford to lose another future. Individually and collectively, we must raise our voices for them, and we must act now. This is the very reason that in July we joined the landmark class action lawsuit to create a consent decree that stopped practices and allowed racially discriminatory policing. It is also why the League is committed to showcasing and enabling accurate portrayals of black lives. The narratives surrounding race and racism both reflect and enable unconscious bias, and they have become increasingly crucial in this era of digital communication. In the age of fake news, the constant flow of inaccurate or incomplete information contribute to real problems. While viral videos of encounters with police on Facebook or weekly news reports of citizens shooting each other over the weekend may be well-intended to call attention to the plight, they can also serve to normalize dehumanization, especially when they are the only stories told about African Americans. It is time to think differently about media balance. It's time for us to really differentiate between what is real and what is fake. What is real is that every day young black people are losing their lives because society continues to define them as expendable. What is fake is that partisan bickering that leads to no real change. What is real is that the historical climate of racism has all too often been recast to create a sugar-coated version of history to justify negative public perceptions. What is fake is pretending that biased policies and practices haven't led to the current situation in Chicago. What is real is that we must get to the root causes and we must reclaim our own narrative. We know that this will not be easy. Over the past year, for example, we have seen even a symbolic gesture against racial oppression can be costly. Colin Kaepernick's public demonstration of kneeling during the national anthem was meant to shine a light on the racial inequity that contributes to police brutality. And he has been punished for it. You and I both know that the national attention Kaepernick's actions received had little to do with his respect of the American flag. Author, scholar and civil rights leader Howard Thurman once said, "During times of war, hatred becomes quite respectable, even though it has to masquerade, often under the guise of patriotism. While we are not literally at war, it has seemed all too easy for patriotic Americans to spew hatred toward Kaepernick and those who followed him, while making no effort to understand or acknowledge his cause. Race-based hatred is nothing new. The fact that there are more than 917 white nationalist hate groups in America, including 32 in Chicago, that espouse white supremacist ideologies, it is not shocking. Organized hatred has been with us for decades. What's troubling is how ambivalent much of America has been about it, how ambivalent much of Chicago has been about it. Our city can do things differently. I wouldn't be standing here today if I didn't believe that Chicago can be a national leader in showing how to prevent social injustices from occurring and reoccurring with frightening frequency. Each of us has an obligation to hold elected officials, policymakers, and other decision makers accountable for advancing social justice. We must acknowledge our collective past and deal with it. We must recognize that we have real problems that some people do not want to solve. The campaign slogan, "Make America Great Again," strongly suggests that returning to the whitewashed historic times when the circumstances of black and brown people were unquestionably more dire is preferable. But the reality is that change is here. It's always been. And with today's technology, it's moving faster than ever. Whether or not everyone likes it, there is no turning back. There is only change. Resistance to change, and then more change. There was a time in our nation's history when African American women were the least employed and the most invisible. Now we are the group most educated in our country. That change did not occur by happenstance. The results of mass incarceration of African American men, the proliferation of guns in our communities, the lack of options for employment, the necessity for black women to ensure their families survived only mirrors our history for more than 100 years. When other factors destroyed our ability to sustain families, we created legacies and we kept going. Despite the narrative we often hear, the pursuit of education is a true African American tradition. It has largely been through education and certainly through resistance that we continue. And change continues. Let's talk about Catherine Powell, a student who participated in League's Project Ready programs. Catherine was born in Chicago and wound up in the foster care system before she was taken in and raised by her grandmother, who nurtured her love of reading. Throughout high school, she was an excellent student. She believed that college was in her future. As a high school junior, she joined Project Ready, where she participated in college tours and college readiness preparation. She set her sights on Princeton University, but she knew that her grandmother, who was on a fixed income, could not contribute to her tuition. Through Project Ready, she took a free 10-week ACT prep course and earned a score of 32 out of 36. When she received her acceptance letter and full ride scholarship from Princeton, she and her grandmother called our program leaders before they shared the news with anyone else. They both credited the League with helping Catherine achieve her goal. Catherine's now a sophomore at Princeton, majoring in English. She wants to be a writer. We know that she will do great things, but only because people will believe that her skill outweighs her skin color and that her opportunities should not be limited by her race, and because she will know her own power and the league will continue to support her to make sure of that. Ensuring that Catherine, along with many more like her, have a bright future should matter to all of us. Her success is all of our success, because together we matter. And as we enter yet another election season, we must recognize that the reckless rhetoric of steadfast ideology of politicians who aim to win at any cost and for any party is not a strategy to make our nation better. And we also know that citizen apathy is not a constructive or productive response. Each of us in this room can be a leader. You don't have to be a president or governor or mayor or CEO to do what's right to improve lives in our city. We just need to remain committed. Let the resilience keep shining through each one of us. You just need to remain focused. Don't let these diversions confuse you. And yes, we just need to stay woke. Thank you.
Sherry Renner, ladies and gentlemen, give it up for our president and CEO one more time. Sherry Renner. And no, that was not wrap it up music. That was planned. Give her another round of applause for her passion, all right? And please know that before the night is over, I will have some Trump jokes.
Please welcome to the stage Dr. Joanne Terrell to deliver the invocation.
It is always fitting, right, and our duty to honor the source. That said, let us pray. Eternal Spirit, creator of the universe with all its growing edges, we invite your prophetic and joyful presence in this place. Be pleased to witness our celebrations of excellence in service. Be pleased with the thoughts of our hearts and the works of our hands. Since you have given us life and purpose, since you defend us with wisdom and power, since you befriend us with love and grace, bless us. Bless the vision of the Urban League for 100 years more. Bless the alliances made and in the making. And bless the food already prepared for us, that we might be morally, emotionally, and physically fit servants of the least of these, for the sake of your peaceable reign. In your many and glorious names we pray. Amen.